So we are going to talk about oligohydramnios, that is too little amniotic fluid around the fetus. So first we'll talk about what happens under normal, during normal pregnancy. So there is formation of amniotic fluid within the amniotic cavity. So the maximum volume of amniotic fluid of 800 ml is reached by the end of 28 weeks of gestation. That is, so by the end of the second trimester, the baby around the fetus, there is the maximum amount of amniotic fluid, that is 800 ml. After that, it falls, gradually it goes down. So by the full term, right, by the 40th week of pregnancy, right, the volume of amniotic fluid is around 500 ml. When you think about the amniotic fluid, it's a balance between the production and resorption, right? It's mainly produced by the kidneys. So the urine is the major source of amniotic fluid, urine, right? And also there is some contribution from the lungs, right? Resorption is mainly by the fetal drinking, fetal ingestion, right? Fetal swallowing. So there is, that is the major source of amniotic fluid, the resorption, right? There is also some resorption by the placenta. So the amount of amniotic fluid is a balance between the production, mainly by the kidneys, and the resorption, predominantly by the fetus swallowing. Any disturbance in this balance result in too much amniotic fluid or too little amniotic fluid. So if there's any disturbance between the production and resorption, right, it can lead to too little amniotic fluid, which is oligohydramnios, too much amniotic fluid, that is polyhydramnios. And how do you get an idea of the amount of amniotic fluid? If you have suspicion about the presence of oligohydramnios or polyhydramnios, right, we can do the amniotic fluid index. It's a measurement using ultrasound, right? Here, we divide the abdomen into four quadrants, right upper quadrant, left upper quadrant, right lower quadrant, left lower quadrant. So by using ultrasound, measure the vertical dimension of the highest pocket in each segment, the vertical dimension of the largest pocket in each abdominal quadrant, right? For example, if right upper quadrant is 1 centimeter, left upper quadrant is 0.5 centimeter, right lower is 0.5 centimeter, left lower is 1 centimeter. Then after that, add all those four quadrants together. The total measurement after adding all those four is 3 centimeter. So that is, normal amniotic fluid index has to be between 5 and 25. When you add all those four quadrants, it has to be between 5 and 25, right? But if it is less than 5, we call it oligohydramnios. If it is more than 25, we call it polyhydramnios. So in this case, it is oligohydramnios because amniotic fluid index is 3. It is oligohydramnios, right? There's another method, right? Here, we take the quadrant, we take the measurement in the quadrant that has the largest pocket, the largest vertical dimension of the quadrant, right? Take that vertical dimension of the largest pocket, right? So it has to be under normal circumstances between 2.1 to 8 centimeters. That the vertical dimension of the largest pocket in one of those quadrants, right? That is between 2.1 to 8 centimeters. If it is 2 centimeter or less than 2 centimeter, we call it oligohydramnios. It's more than 8 centimeter, we call it polyhydramnios. So here, in this case, we don't have to take the measurements of all four. Just take select the quadrant with the largest pocket and take its vertical dimension, right? It's single measurement. So when we think about oligohydramnios, it is too little amniotic fluid, right? So confirmed by doing the amniotic fluid index, which is less than 5. What are the causes of oligohydramnios? Right? Renal agenesis. Right? So the kidneys are underdeveloped. So there is no urine production. So there is too little amniotic fluid. Right? Actually, this leads to Potter syndrome. Right? Infantile polycystic kidney disease. That is the congenital situation. Right? Infantile polycystic kidney disease, which is autosomal recessive. Right? So there is the manifestations occur during fetal life. Right? So that's the cause of oligohydramnios. Posterior urethral valves, it's a cause of oligohydramnios. Chronic placental insufficiency, right? Preeclampsia and post-date pregnancies, they can cause oligohydramnios. premature rupture of membrane can result in oligohydramnios. So how do you diagnose? On examination, abdomen is small for the dates, right? So the abdomen, you know, the even at the full term, you see the abdomen is small, right? When you measure the amniotic fluid index, it is less than 5, right? What are the risk of oligohydramnios? Umbilical cord compression, right? Think about the situation. There is too little amniotic fluid. So the normally the umbilical cord is floating in the amniotic fluid. But here, the amniotic fluid is, there is not enough fluid to, there is no cushion for the fetus, right? And so the baby has less amniotic fluid to move around. So the umbilical cord can be compressed, right? That lead to fetal asphyxia. If the umbilical cord can be compressed between the fetal parts, right? Between the fetus and the uterine wall, right? It can lead to fetal asphyxia, fetal distress, right? And so oligohydramnios lead to increased perinatal morbidity and mortality, right? And also it leads to atypical appearance of the baby, right? Potter sequence, that's what we call a Potter sequence, right? Think about the situation. There is less cushion for the baby, right? Because the amniotic fluid supply because of the amniotic fluid, it is a major cushion for the baby, right? In the oligohydramnios, this cushion is not there. So there is pressure on the fetus from the uterine wall, right? That leads to underdevelopment, you know, the pressure on the fetal part. So there is club feet. The face become fat, flat faces. Those are the features of Potter sequence, right? Atypical appearance of the baby, the club feet and flat faces. And also there is in oligohydramnios, there is pulmonary hypoplasia, right? Because under normal circumstances, baby inhale amniotic fluid. So the amniotic fluid enter the fetal lung, right? That causes lung expansion and that enhances the lung growth, right? Expansion of the lung by the amniotic fluid enhances the lung growth. So in the presence of oligohydramnios, there is less fluid entering the amniotic fluid, right? So that affects the lung growth. So there is failure of lung growth. So there is pulmonary hypoplasia in oligohydramnios. Right. So that's all about the oligohydramnios. If you have any questions, please post them in the comment section below. And also please be sure to like this video and subscribe to my channel for future lectures. Thank you.